This is Ham Radio Now, the most important ham radio program on the internet, episode 345.
The most important? Are you sure?
It's one of those things you can say, and no one can challenge you because there's no way to prove
I'm challenging you.
One way or the other.
But it's pretty
good.
This
is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet.
All right.
Episode 345. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. And before we get to these relatively unimportant people, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the programs, get anything out of them, hamradionow.tv is the place to go see Arvin. Click the pig, send money, get me out to places like this. In the background, the hubbub in the background is the end of the TAPR Digital Communications Conference. And when I got here, there were these whispers from everybody in my ear saying, "Did you know that Jeri Ellsworth was here?" And I actually didn't until I saw you here. I knew you were a ham. I saw you briefly in the distance at Dayton and was all excited about it.
And you didn't chase me down?
I didn't want to feel like a stalker. So this is Jeri Ellsworth, and your call is AI6 what?
AI6TK.
Okay, and you couldn't get AR6 because it's not within
the... I know.
You wanted it, I'll bet.
You could go for that vanity sign someday.
Yeah, can you do that? Can you advance forward in vanity signs?
Alas, AR is not in the United States block of call signs. It ends with AL or something, AM. I don't know. But AR is not there. So you're going to be artificial intelligence, not...
tickle kittens, I don't know.
Yeah, and you're here with your friend Amy, who... All I know about you is your name is Amy. Hold that mic up close because it is getting noisy.
Yeah, sure. My call sign is Kilo Mike 6 Foxtrot Zulu Echo.
Okay.
It's very long. I'm going to shorten that up after PacificCon this year because I'm going for my extra.
All right, excellent. And you were licensed about a year ago in
PacificCon.
Last September. And
me as well.
Same deal. So because I don't know who you are, what's the connection? You traveling companions?
Yes, and actually we work together. So I work for her startup company.
All right.
What's left of it?
Can't talk about that. We're embargoed. So I want to talk about you guys at Ham Radio primarily, but believe it or not, there'll be people who don't know who you are.
What?
Yeah, I know. And within
crazy.
The ham radio. Yeah. And so let me see if I can do a 10-second resume for you. High school dropout, race car driver, computer hacker, and you've done something lately. I forget what it is.
Electrical engineering, okay. And product design, and startup co-founder.
Yeah, and then this glasses thing.
So my startup, we're doing augmented reality glasses.
Augmented reality, but not virtual reality.
No. It's something you can see through and mixes digital content with the real world. So we can create magical game characters springing up out of your table, or you can interact with CAD models with a stylus in a volumetric space just floating right out in front of you.
Okay, so I guess we could call you co-founder. Mm-hmm. One of my problems is I'm getting very old and names drop out of my memory. So castAR.
Correct.
Yeah, it's the company that you co-founded. Yep. And we are embargoed from saying anything about at this point.
Yeah, but there might be some exciting news.
Might be.
Maybe.
It'll be great to be able to break news, but can't do that today.
Yeah. I'll go right to ham radio media outlets to break all the news about augmented reality.
That's the primary place to go.
Yeah.
So I did a little research. I didn't know who you were. And I think when I first heard you on Twitter talking about what you were doing, you were saying, well, okay, cool, it's a woman in technology, and that is rare enough. When I heard you had a ham license, it was like, oh, wow, that is really great. But... the first question I asked was, do you live around here? We're in St. Louis. The reason I asked, do you live around here, was because I thought the only reason that you would show up at a ham radio activity was because it was convenient, it was easy. You know, well, no, of course not.
How dare you?
You live in Silicon Valley. You came for this. You guys both came for this. It was your idea? You talked her into it?
Actually, no. Some friends of ours that we met when we were at Hamvention. My mind is throwing
a blank. Mud pit.
Yeah, when we were in the mud pit. Actually, we went to the TAPR banquet, AMPSAT banquet, one of the first nights that we were there. We met some really awesome folks, very like-minded folks. And they started talking about this event, and we're like, oh, that sounds like fun. That's right up our alley, so let's try to make it to it. So I took care of all the flights and everything else to get here, and here we are.
Okay. And we're Uber nerds.
Yeah.
I mean, what's not to love about the TAPR events? You've got to go.
Yeah, we'll talk about them in a little bit more detail in just a minute. What I want to do is sort of apologize, because I kind of have the feeling that anyone who is at a really high level of either technology or just celebrity. Like, you know, Tim Allen. Tim Allen's not here. Tim Allen got a ham license, but he's not here. I think, yeah, they get their ham license because, you know, somebody told them it would be a good idea, but they didn't become hams. You guys, from the interview you did on AmateurLogic with George, clearly became hams. You got the technology, you got the language, you got all that stuff, and that is going to make everybody really happy that you're not just celebrity hams, you're real hams.
With real mic fright.
That's right.
Like, I have a hard time doing the hobby sometimes because I'm just scared to do it. Like, I'm acclimated to doing podcasts and making YouTube videos, but to get on that microphone and do a QSO,
that's why
my hands are shaking. And,
PSK,
love JT65 on the 40-meter band. You can just sit there watching TV in the background, and you know your computer gives you a little notification that someone's gotten back to you. You can just click the mouse, go back to TV, wait for that sound again, click the mouse, go back to TV.
Okay, then, so you're not making my point here that you're really dedicated hams.
Well, no. Tell them about
it's great because mostly we do QRP, so we're doing putting out very low power, and we've been finding that we can reach Japan really easily, New Zealand, Australia, you know, on like 1 watt. So it's pretty amazing, like how far you can reach on very little power.
I actually find that really fascinating about the hobby. Is like the weirdness of the atmosphere adds like this new dimension to like communicating. Like I just grab my cell phone and communicate with someone in Japan, but you know, just throwing a watt out into the ether and it just happens to be at the gray line and then like whoop, they show up. It's like, it's just bizarre and fun.
See, gray line. She knows the, you know, the technology and stuff. You at least were aware of ham radio for a long time. Did you get introduced because of her?
No, I had actually, you know, had a lot of friends throughout my life that had gotten into ham radio, but I never really got into it. Jeri, on the other hand, had a lot of mentors when she was younger that were ham radio operators that always tried to convince her to get involved. And so for her to come back around to it now is, you know, makes sense. Makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, when I was just really small, I lived in a small community in Oregon, like 4,000 people or something like that. And I was into electronics and computers, so I'd hang out at the library, and the ham radio operators would show up there and invite me to their ham shack, not creepy at all. And sit there.
Hey, little lady, would you like to see my ham shack?
Nothing creepy.
I've got a tri-band beam.
Sit there and chain smoke in their little shack out behind the the house. One of them actually had like a gardening shed with all their ham gear. But they were the folks that gave me test equipment, taught me some fundamentals of electronics, encouraged me. Mortified when I started making pirate radio stations. Even more mortified when I started playing with CB radios and.
Hey, 10-4, good buddy. You got to break the copy.
Yep.
Why didn't you get a ham license back when you were a kid?
I was interested in building things primarily, and doing Morse code was just too boring for me at the time. I didn't appreciate the communication aspects of it. I was more about building. And yeah, I kind of half-hearted would try and just never.
Yeah, so Morse code was.
Yeah, that was my blocker.
Yeah. So, and you just reminded me that I forgot to give people the title of the show that I came up with yesterday. This is Ham Radio Now, episode, what was it, 345? Appliance Boy meets Circuit Girl. That was your old podcast, right?
Oh, yeah.
Fat Man and Circuit Girl.
That's just like using CB radios, right?
Yeah. So.
I'm a troll, too, so.
Excellent.
I love throwing out CB radios, because the ham radio guys are like, yeah, and I had a 200-watt linear on my CB radio as well.
Yeah. Well, your history is all hands-on technology, hardware and software?
Yeah, a little bit.
Are you more hardware or more software?
Way more hardware. So my background is primarily like chip design, system-level design. Recent years, I got more into full product design. But if push comes to shove, I can do a little bit of software.
Okay. And you can give me, as the king of the appliance operators and a guy that can barely solder a coax connector together, you can give me as much crap as you want about that.
All right.
What do you do at the company? What's your?
I'm a prototyping engineer, so I'm kind of like a Swiss Army knife in the office. Typically, when some of the engineers need a fixture made or something else that they need really, really quickly, they'll come to me and I'll talk it through with them and I'll figure out what it is they exactly need and I'll get it turned around within a very short period of time so that they can get up and running and testing.
So do you build it yourself or are you
yes.
just... Okay, so you're hardware as well.
Yeah, I'm mostly hardware. I've dabbled a little bit in electronics as well, and I'm just kind of starting to play around with some programming.
So now on to the Digital Communications Conference, which the stalwarts are still debating the finer points of the last talk, I'm sure, or all the talks that they've been.
Yeah.
What did you think?
I liked it, and I liked the lightning round or lightning.
I loved the lightning talks. They were great.
Yeah, and that was a last minute thing because there was a guy who was out sick. Couldn't make it. They needed to fill in an hour or 45 minutes. And so they invited people from the audience who had no idea that this was going to happen to come up with 5-minute talks.
Yeah.
And they all had PowerPoints with them.
I know. It was great. I mean, so we went through some really deep topics in the morning. So everyone's kind of getting tired. And then they brought out the lightning talks. And it was just like fast paced. And people are talking about these exciting projects at a really high level. It's like, I hope they do it again next year.
They're talking about doing it both days and all that.
Oh, that'd be great.
How come you guys didn't volunteer for one? There were no pads of paper
actually,
in front of you.
I actually regret not bringing some projects out. I was honestly a little disappointed in the demo room. And I was in there thinking, geez, I have so many projects that are just kind of mothballs. I could have pulled something out and brought. So next year, definitely, I'll be bringing something.
Will you do a talk?
Maybe. We'll see if there's something appropriate. They're pushing for me to do a talk.
I can imagine.
When I do presentations, I like it to be, kind of different than what other people have done. So I have to find the thing that speaks to me, and then I have to actually do it and then present it. So committing to a talk next year until I have that one thing that's digital communication for ham radio that's kind of different than what other people are doing, that'll have to come to me first.
Because none of the projects that you have worked on professionally have a direct ham radio application. I'm thinking.
I've done some high-end video compression ICs. So, compressing live video in real time,
Okay, so we've got to get Mel Whitten in here to talk about doing the video stuff.
I did a toy that had some RF in it that got canceled, which was really sad. But I've orbited ham radio for years and years and years. And, every, couple years, I'm like, I should go get my ham license. And
And I guess I want to pound a little harder on the idea that it was Morse code that was... It's not that you never could have learned Morse code. You both probably could have learned it. It's just...
Oh, we're both learning it now.
Yeah.
Okay, so...
We're making a concerted effort to...
Oh, cool.
Without Morse code, it's going to destroy ham radio. I'm just channeling what people used to
It's the T-shirts. It's a... without CW, it's just CB.
Yeah.
Which apparently would be fine. But we'll give you another year. Mel Whitten. Hey, Mel Whitten. She's got video compression stuff that you need to know about.
That's right. Okay. We'll move it on over to ham radio.
Because we're doing TV now, digital TV.
Actually, that was one of the things that fascinated me when I was a kid. Slow scan television. I was like enamored with the prospect of doing, you know, television, because I was doing all the pirate radio station, and to take it one step further and actually be able to transmit images, I thought that was pretty cool. I got some books and stuff and looked at it. It was way too complicated for like a teenager.
So you have suggested that we do the Skype interview. That would be the typical Ham Radio Now 2-hour interview.
Well, I think I could do more than 2 hours. I have a record on another podcast where I just droned on, and I think we went way over 2 hours.
Okay, well, we can try to break the record. I don't know. But it was a solo effort? Is this still online somewhere?
I'm totally spacing the name of the podcast now. This is Dave Jones and Chris Gammel's thing.
The EV
blog or whatever. Yeah. So somehow I managed to occupy a couple hours. So you probably don't want to bring me on.
Absolutely do. Well, we talked at the dinner last night. We shouted at each other at the dinner last night.
I know, my throat's kind of scratchy from...
It was loud in the room. Everybody was having really amazing conversations, and so...
Yeah, so the topics that were brought up, did you even look and see what people were going to be talking about before you came out, or did you just say, this looks...
No, my kind of people, let's go.
Yeah, pretty much.
And we're interested in at least learning about everything people were talking about?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I mean, digital communication is very close to my heart because most of my career has been algorithms and digital-type designs. So I find it pretty interesting. Although, again, I think more of the analog effects have been tickling my fancy lately with ham radio than digital. I mean, even with JT65, it's just a super... or FT8, the latest edition. It's like, it's an easy way to experiment without having to go through the formalities of doing the, you know, a phone contact or, you know, CW.
I'm going to get the impression that you don't want ham radio to be a busman's holiday for you. That you wanted ham radio to be something to relax in and have fun.
Oh, yeah.
Not just to go spend a few more hours at work.
Right.
I don't know. I enjoy doing work.
I was a little worried someone was bringing me a camera that I left in the room, not taking my camera away. I'm still on.
I think we're both kind of workaholics. So if we're not doing things at work, we're working on projects at home. And so our typical weekends are actually just building stuff.
Yeah.
So she's working on stuff constantly.
I've got some vacuum tubes on my table right now. We got those things biased up and...
Vacuum tubes.
Of course. Hollow space.
Real
the solid
ham radio
state
glows
stuff
in
is
dark.
In the past. Hollow space is coming back.
Yeah, transistors are just flashing the pan. It's just a fan.
It'll never catch on.
Yeah.
Actually, when I was a kid, like transistors were available, of course, but they were really expensive. But you could go to swap meets and garage sales and get these old tube radios for cheap, and you could bang on tubes really hard and never damage them. And so all my pirate radio stuff was tube. So it's been kind of fun, you know, firing up and getting some filaments glowing again.
Okay, she thinks you can't damage a tube very easily. So so don't give her any of your UHF kilowatt amplifiers to play with. Because like that, you know, your $700 4CX1000. So the conference met expectations, exceeded expectations. I mean, you go to professional conferences all the time. You're a headliner at some of them, and
I think it was very good. I'm excited that they're looking at constantly expanding the speakers, and the way it was described to me, like if you don't like the set of talks this year, next year it's completely different set of talks, and they don't really push for any particular direction with the talks. They just let the community come together and create it. So that's a pretty exciting part of it. You know, some of the talks really dug it. And then other ones I was like, I'm going to go get a cup of coffee. So,
which is pretty much the case, I think, for everybody in the room. You see people circulate in and out. Mm-hmm. The attendance looked really good. And seeing more than half the people here for the first time, which means they're mostly going to be locals here in the St. Louis area.
Did they announce where the next one's going to be?
I know they announced it in Albuquerque.
Oh, Albuquerque.
Okay, so it's close.
Cool.
Closer.
Closer. Yeah, I got the impression talking to some of the folks in the audience that, you know, since this moves around, that they'll come out when it moves, you know, close to their location. So it seems like it's worth, like, occasionally jumping in and seeing the new folks that come out.
I think what Steve Bible refers to is the traveling circus, the folks that go to everyone no matter where it is. And that group is probably about 20 or 30. And then the rest is filled in from the local folks. Mm-hmm. And I don't think it's been in the San Francisco area in my memory. I mean, I go back to 2008.
We're going to go to MUD, right?
Yeah, the microwave, was it the microwave users?
Update. Microwave update.
Microwave update.
Where's that?
It's another moving one.
It's happening, I think, in Santa Clara.
Okay, that's a ham radio event that mm-hmm. I have yeah. apparently never heard of.
Come on out.
Yeah.
I'm an appliance operator. My reason for being here is these television things.
Uh-huh.
They roped me into doing this in 2008, and I've been doing them ever since.
Oh.
But, and I know television. You know, I can carry on a halfway lucid interview. And again, I can solder a PL259 if you don't want it done very well and will probably come apart within a year.
10-4, good buddy.
Great. I've been insulted by Jeri Ellsworth.
And we're starting, you know, talking about HF connectors and stuff like that. We're picking up the ham habit, like hoarding things. Like, I'm already collecting my bucket of oxidized HF connectors because you just can't get rid of them.
Yeah.
You never know.
Large reels of coax. And
if we stop by HRO and like, yeah, we want a spool of coax. And first of all, they're like, who are these ladies? And we're buying like a huge, you know, 200, 500 foot spool of coax. Like, are you sure you don't want just like 50 feet of it? We're like, no.
Like, we went through that.
Went that bam.
So have you set up stations at home, strung antennas yet?
Yeah.
Yeah. We've at least, we've got a multi-band dipole up right now. We've got a mag loop that we built that we need to get set up. It's an 80 meter and 160 meter, big, huge, 7.5 foot diameter copper tubes. Set up a bi-directional beverage antenna as well.
Which upset our landlord.
Yeah.
So you don't own the house. You're
no. It's,
he's freaked out. Like, is this an electric fence or something?
You know, it's like 2.6 acres. And we're thinking, great, we can put antennas up all over the place. We put this thing up, and within an hour of leaving for work, I get a text message from the landlord with pictures of the beverage antenna going, Amy, what is this? And I have to like write back, and it's just an antenna. It's fine.
Don't trip over it.
Yeah.
How high up off the ground?
It's a kind of a privacy fence that runs between two properties, and so it's about 6 feet high or so.
Mm. Okay, and for 160, 80?
No, it seems to work best at 20 and 40.
Yeah.
A beverage?
Yeah.
I mean, I have a little bit of technology. I understand that those were the receiving antennas.
I don't think we have
choice
enough
for
length.
Like 160.
Yeah, I don't think we quite have the length for 80 or 160.
Yeah, you need to get a couple hundred feet.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's definitely like switching between the dipole and the beverage antenna. The noise floor just drops immediately and the signal remains. So,
yeah, it's cool. Pretty neat watching the waterfall display and watching the noise just drop off as soon as you switch it over.
Yeah, I have not heard people talk about doing that on 20 meters, so.
Yeah.
Maybe they've just never tried. No one told you couldn't do it.
Exactly.
Although if they told you you couldn't do it,
she'd
you
do
probably
it
would have done it sooner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, take that. Take that ham radio. I think that's your camera. Well, you're on
take
both
that.
Of them.
Take that. Don't tell me I can't do anything.
So this, I've got like about an hour's worth left on these SD cards. We can go. We can't hit the limit. We can go as long as you want.
When it goes to static, you ran out of.
Yeah. When the little red lights go off, then we'll know we're in trouble. I do want to ask about the being almost the only two women at this conference.
Yeah.
There have been women at TAPR conferences, but I mean, you went to Dayton and Pacificon.
Yeah.
And you got the idea, and you've probably known for a long time that ham radio is a collection of old men. some women,
nothing creepy with that.
Yeah, most of whom are licensed because of their husbands. Not all, but not all at all. And you can leave that open. I want all the background. Definitely want the hubbub.
Because they're bummed, Steve.
Yeah. people are so polite. They're trying to give us television space here. This is what we're here for.
No one's walked in front of the camera yet.
Yeah, but that happens all the time. Yeah.
I think Steve got in behind me, though.
So,
I think it's, you know, I've worked in tech industry. I was race car driver at one point. I'm pretty used to every industry I hang out in is typically more men. And it comes with its pros and its cons. So, you know, you walk into a TAPR event, people turn their head and they're like, well, I want to go talk to those two.
Yeah.
And so, you know, if we were just any old person walking in, we probably have to do a little bit more work to get to know folks. So, there's some plus sides. And then there's hilarious, funny sides, like when sometimes people talk down to us.
At the swap meets, those are the best. You walk up and you start looking at some of the equipment and you know what you're looking at, but then the guys are completely baffled that you know what you're looking at. And immediately their first response is, waiter, are you ham radio operators?
Yeah. My favorite thing to do is kind of play a little bit dumb sometimes. Be like, what do you have here? And then... And so then they'll start talking down to you, and you're like,
A mansplain it.
Oh, how many kilovolts is that vacuum capacitor rated to? And they're like,
Yeah, my wife got that one time. My wife's a double E, and she's got her advanced.
Nice.
And I actually met her when she was in a class studying Morse code. And of course, I was doing the video. I just moved to town, and I was doing some video for the club to know people. It's the thing I could do. And I'm in the class, and I'm pointing a video camera at this attractive blonde lady. And so my first impression of who is now my wife, Cindy, KD4ACW, is that's an attractive blonde woman studying Morse code. And her first impression of me was, I wish that annoying man with a video camera would stop pointing it in my face. So we were at a ham fest. She had her advanced class license, and we're meeting one of the ARRL officials. And it's like, oh, did you get your code-free tech? Isn't that nice? She's got a double E.
Yeah.
You know, you're a high school dropout. I'm a college dropout, at least. You know, we've got something.
I won't hold that against you.
Nah.
You could have got it out of the way earlier.
So, I mean, the question you can't answer, but I have to ask, and, you know, and maybe over the course of however long you spend with ham radio, you'll see some ways to influence this, is how do we attract a more diverse, first of all, another generation, whether it's male or female, because not only do we not have young women, we don't have young men either. As you look out on that, what do you think might attract them?
Do you have any ideas?
Yeah, I actually have one off the top of my head. So one of the talks here, which actually was one of my more favorite ones, was, I can't remember his name, was it Scotty maybe? He was talking about teaching his troop.
Scotty Cowling, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. How to make the really nice, like, Morse keyers, you know, so that he could get them interested in ham radio type stuff. And he's not the first one I've heard, you know, say that they've done stuff with their scout troops to get them interested in ham radio. What I don't really ever hear is we worked with the Girl Scouts to get them involved in ham radio stuff. And I was a Girl Scout, too, when I was growing up. And, you know, we did a lot of crafty things, you know, you made Christmas ornaments, you know, or you baked cookies or something. And I was always very jealous of my male friends at the time because they were off doing really cool stuff. They were off doing all the cool stuff that I wanted to do. They were building things and doing crazy electronics. I think it would be interesting if we put a little bit more emphasis on teaching young girls what it means to get into ham radio and the types of stuff that they can build as well.
One of the things I always harp on when people are talking about getting people into ham radio is that you will get some people interested. You're not going to make hams out of everybody.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And male or female. You're going to make engineers out of every young girl.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But there are, like you, there are some that want to do that and either don't feel it's appropriate because that's what you've been taught. You never had that problem.
No. Single father raising me, we had to share the burdens. No, I think it's exposure, right? The more exposure, the more your odds go up, and then the more...
You know, as long as the opportunities are there, too. I mean, young girls can decide if that's something they're interested in or something they're not interested in, but it has to be, you know, put out there for them to actually try, for them to know that it's even available, right? You know, if we continue to perpetuate this idea that, you know, that's for boys and these other things are for girls, then they won't even know that that opportunity is there for them. We have to make it available consistently so those of them that want to do that can be drawn to it and actually learn it.
Yeah, I've heard of women leading things like Code Camp for girls. You might have heard, heard of that. There's no ham radio in that. It's not Morse Code Camp. Sorry, old farts. It's computer code, something you could probably benefit from. You're more hardware than software.
Oh, now he's dishing it back. Okay, I'll take it.
I'm feeling a little more comfortable on that. can we get the Code Camp for girls people to add a ham radio element to it?
I think that would be great. Yeah.
Because I think that there's a future in ham radio that's valuable not only to people who are in it, but to the general community. At least I hope so.
Yeah.
It certainly meant a lot to my career.
I loved Ward's talk today, or yesterday. Yesterday, about ham 2.0. I think he's spot on. And, you know, not to steal any of his thunder, like I think his concepts of more distributed ham-type systems will be interesting for the techie crowd. We'll probably draw in more of the people that are already in tech. Like, what does it mean when your radio is not really in your home? You know, and what if you can cluster a bunch of radios together and process that data in a new way and visualize it in new ways? And I think that'll be interesting. And I think if there's a way we can make interfaces more familiar for, you know, folks that are acclimated to iPads and tablets and phones.
Appliance operators.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it's the ham radio gear, like there's so many buttons and knobs, it's pretty alien. And kind of the last thing, I guess.
Because you're an interface person.
Yeah.
In large part.
Yeah. That's, we think about that at work all the time. Like, how do you make augmented reality, which is completely different than anything that people have experienced before, close to like a tablet interface so that they can take one small step instead of one giant step into. Yeah, and ham radio, boy, that first step is really hard. I'm really technical and I struggled getting going. I don't know how you felt about
definitely.
It. Yeah, I mean, that probably wipes out a majority
of it. You were talking last night about the out-of-box experience, the first thing that you want when somebody is looking at a device of any kind and they take it out of the box, instant gratification. Mm-hmm. You want it to do something right away. And a ham radio is generally
definitely
not going to do that.
You look at all those buttons and knobs and you're like, what am I looking at? Oh my God, I'm going to have to read the manual. I really don't like
reading
manuals.
And then the manual doesn't help you because it's more of tribal knowledge of how to use a ham gear.
And actually, we recently just got the, was it the D74 Kenwood handhelds? And we're both saying, you know, we need to find some time to actually go through the manual and figure this stuff out because it's really complicated.
Yeah.
You know, there's a really deep menu system in there that you kind of have to go through if you want to get it programmed up properly. And so
yeah,
and it seems like there was a notion in not too many years ago, like you get beginners in on handhelds and get them talking on repeaters. You know, when we went to HRO the first time just trying to explore to figure out what we wanted to do with ham radio, they pushed us towards handhelds. I'm like, that seems really boring. You know?
That's step one for most people.
Yeah.
Not appropriate perhaps for you guys.
I don't know. It seems like repeaters are pretty dead these days. So, I don't know.
Not just these days. You know, people have been complaining about that for a couple of decades now.
I think there's a way you can make ham radio more snackable, I guess, is the best way to describe it. Like, out-of-box experience really fast, and then you get your first, like, reward from it. I mean, it's just like almost any user experience these days. You get some instant gratification. And for me, like, going after the QRZ awards was pretty exciting because it was instant. I hooked it up. I after a lot of work, I figured out how to get it all integrated seamlessly into JT65 application. Then it just updated the web page immediately. And then I started knocking off the awards.
But you still had to get a radio going and string up an antenna and to put some RF. It'd
be awesome if the radios just did JT65 out of the box and you just put your Wi-Fi password and it showed up on QRZ or
Log. We have a word for that some hams don't like. It's called Echo Link.
Oh, I haven't tried that. I'll love it.
It's a hybrid. It connects to some repeaters, but you don't need repeaters. You just talk to people. It's Skype within ham radio.
Mm.
So some hams love it. Some hams don't. Part of that is not everybody can put up an antenna. Not everybody
can
put anything that's going to be reasonably effective. But I don't know how much really at least deep out-of-box experience ham radio can give you, because it is... in addition to pointing you at handy talkies, I imagine that they pointed the fire hose at you. And I was like, here's everything there is to know about ham radio, and as fast as I can explain it.
In one ear, out the other.
Yeah.
But did that happen? Whenever you talk to hams, well, you've been involved with it for a long time, so maybe...
We actually had a pretty good friend that worked at the local ham radio outlet, and every time we would go in and chat with him, he was a
Hi,
little
Don.
Bit... Yeah, he was a little bit more on the a little bit more on the conservative side in terms of his recommendations to us. So I think in some ways that probably helped a bit, that we weren't getting overwhelmed by stuff. I think he probably recognized that if we started to get that glazed look in our eyes, that
maybe he also knew who he was dealing with.
Yeah, too much information all at once.
So, Mike Fright. I mean, you obviously have no trouble talking in groups as an expert to two people in one-on-ones and stuff. So surprisingly, when I interviewed Leo Laporte, he had the same thing. He said, I talk on television all day, every day.
Yeah.
And try to push the ham radio microphone and talk to somebody, and it's, I don't know what to say.
I can't speak for Jeri, but for me, it's... you want to do everything right when you're on there.
And our procedures seem so arcane.
Yeah, and you have this fear. For some reason, when I'm doing data modes, it's very clear cut. There's very clear responses that you kind of go by. When you're talking, it's that fear that you're not going to remember exactly what you need to say to make the contact complete. And so I think that's what keeps me from getting into voice as much. Of course, our first contact that we ever made as soon as we got our call signs was a voice contact, and it was
World's phone contact.
Yeah,
CQ Magazine's World phone.
Yeah,
we're like, okay, we're gonna dive in head first. I don't know how this is gonna work, and I found a big pile up, and I'm like, okay, I'm gonna just do it. And the guy was actually really nice, because made the contact after listening for about an hour and kind of getting the cadence. Get in there, made the contact, and like, oh, by the way, you're my first ever ham radio contact. And he stopped. And he's like, wow, oh my God, a DX contact for the first, whoa. And so it was really flattering and fun.
It's great that you ran into somebody like that. Not everybody would do that, but a lot of hams would, recognizing what value suddenly they're providing to you.
I really wanted to make my first contact with the same guy. And then we looked at the frequency, and I was like, I can't. I'm a general, and she's an extra. And it was right in that little extra space.
She was sitting next to you? Well, here's a clue. She could have been your control operator.
That's true.
She
could have. Now you know.
But we decided we wanted to kind of, if I was going to be a general, I was going to move over and find somebody that I would normally be able to contact on my own radio. So I ended up getting a gal out of Vancouver, BC, which was pretty awesome.
Yeah, to find another woman to talk to.
Yeah, that was great. That was great.
That's winning a lot.
And then I heard her much later on, during the day, trying to break through a pileup with somebody. I think it was in one of the islands in the Caribbean. So everybody was trying to reach this one guy, and I heard her trying to get through a number of times. And I was like, that was the gal I made my first contact with. It was pretty cool.
So contesting, DX, things like that, those are all... I'm inventing a word. I've been working on... I haven't introduced this to the world yet, so this is the world introduction of a word that I'm inventing.
I'm ready.
Non-versation.
Non-versation.
It's you're talking, you're communicating, but you're not conversing.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
It's safer.
Okay.
Yeah. Feels safer.
Yeah.
So for people taking baby steps into mic fright or crossing mic fright, non-versations, and the ham radio is loaded with them.
I mean, that's all I do is contests. Like, you know, contests will come up. I'm like, okay, I'm going to try to get over some of my mic fright, do the exchange, and
And then it's done, right?
My heart's going 1,000 miles a minute still, and I've done it 2 or 3 times now. And then I go to JT65. Click. I think that, you know, what's interesting, you start to prepare for ham radio by reading all the books and watching the YouTube videos, people talking about all the procedures, and you got to do it right, and so many rules, and you memorize the rules, and don't be out of band, and it's just like scary. And then you finally get on the air, and it's just like, I'm petrified to do something wrong, and then you're just, you know, shortwave listening, you hear like fights going on. It's like, I don't want to cause a fight. And I don't know how you address those
things. You don't
mind
causing fights in other venues.
Just YouTube.
Yeah.
It's like,
good and, buddy. And within ham radio, at some point, you'll be comfortable causing a fight too. It's just, this is new territory for you.
So do you have any tips? Well, so if I want to be a mild troll. I don't want to go and just start jamming or do anything like that. Just like call CB operators.
My first tip is 14313.
What's that?
That's a notorious frequency. Where
oh, gosh.
It's a really good frequency because it gathers all of the bad actors together in one place, so they're not spread out across all of our bands. There's a few
That's
others.
That's great.
You're one of a few others. Bad language and, you know, just tune in 14313.
The honeypot of...
And it was a self-inflicted honeypot that they drew themselves together.
Wow.
There's a little bit more of that. I can't tell you how to have a conversation like this on ham radio. Well, part of the problem is this is a conversation. I can interrupt you. You can interrupt me.
Right.
When it's pushed the button, I can't hear anything anymore. I'm just monologuing. That makes conversations, it tends to make conversations more stilted.
Mm.
So it becomes a little more difficult. But there's really no reason why you can't have a conversation like this or like with anybody else over ham radio, mm-hmm. except that we have a real hard time doing that. Yeah.
Well, stop it.
Yeah. Tell them. Well, tell them.
Bob Newhart.
Bob Newhart.
Stop it.
Stop it.
Yeah. Fix it. So maybe we can. I don't know. Maybe one of the things I'll dedicate ham radio now to is teaching people how to have better ham. And hams have been complaining about that for some time. It's like,
yeah.
Well, you know, I'm just thinking back. You know, ham radio operators that took me under their wing when I was like a teenager were complaining about all the same things. We're getting no new young people. There's not enough women. Like, this whole slow scan TV thing's going to destroy the... or whatever it is.
Ham radio has been ended many times.
Like, I don't think anything ever changes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's people, because it's just... You
know, and now there's a new frequency that we get to play around on.
Oh, yeah.
Is it 680? Or what?
600 megahertz, 600 meters and like 20,000 million meters. You know, just if you squeak your voice up high enough, you're on the new ham band.
Yeah.
Have you been eyeballing big spools of magnet wire to make your antenna?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm excited about making an antenna for that.
She's going to be the pioneer of FT8 on all these obscure...
Yeah, because the band is like this wide.
You know, I know. So
there's not going to be any phone.
Challenge. It's a challenge. I love that.
Yeah. Cool. So you guys going to build any ham radio stuff? First of all, for yourselves, and then for the rest of us.
I don't know.
Well, tell them about the ukulele amp.
The ukulele amp?
For the cruise.
It took me a moment to figure out. I don't know how much I should say about this, because Holland and America might come after us.
Everything.
FCC's not watching your channel, are they?
No, I'm sorry.
So Holland America used to be...
There's nobody left at the FCC.
They used to be very friendly to ham operators. And so you know, if you had contacted the ship and you could get permission to bring some gear aboard if you wanted to play with your ham radio while you were on your cruise. So we went on this cruise this past March, and we really wanted to try to make some contacts while
Where'd
we were out in international waters. Out of San Diego, down to Cabo San Lucas, and then up around to Laredo, and then back again. And it was with a boat full of nerds, which was amazing.
Oh, cool.
Jonathan Colton.
Yeah, the Jonathan, cruise. The Joko cruise.
Okay, I think I've
heard
We're
doing
that.
It again this next year, too, with some friends that we actually met at Hamvention. So.
And we're not going to illegally broadcast. No way.
No, no. What frequency will we be not listening for that on?
So what we decided to do is we were going. She worked on a stealth transceiver, and it looked like I built the case for it, and it had a cute little picture on it and everything else, and it had. So I think where we put the antenna in, I put MIDI.
I see, ukulele amp.
Yeah, exactly. And I brought it with my ukulele.
Audio in.
Yeah, audio in, audio out. And then we made
BNC. Interesting audio choice.
Exactly. And then I built a really simple mag loop antenna that we were going to use, including a dial and everything, for trying to get it in. And I used all audio cables and audio
RCA connectors.
Yeah, RCA connectors and everything else to do this. And tested it at home. It worked great. So we're like, we're all set. If anybody like searches the bag, I'll just be like, yeah, that's my audio equipment for my ukulele.
It was the Radiation King ukulele amp.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
These two hear the end of ham radio as we know it.
Yeah, watch out. Just like slow scan television is going to destroy everything.
So did you get to put it on the air?
We made a very concerted effort to make some contacts. And we did see later on, if you went to PSK Reporter, you could actually see our signal getting out. But it didn't go the direction that we thought it would. So as we're heading south, we were on the starboard side of the ship. And so we thought that we would actually...
Balcony?
We had a balcony. And so we
didn't go up to the Lido deck to do this?
Nope, we had it out on the balcony of the room. So we thought that we would actually get out across the Pacific Ocean. The weird thing was that it actually... Our signals were heard in the States. So the signal went through the ship and then...
Weird.
Yeah, it was weird.
Or maybe around the world.
Just, I like that better.
Actually, that...
What band
that
were you on, 20?
40.
I think we were playing on 40.
40. Yeah. Magma.
And putting out milliwatts. I mean, this was a, you know, definitely a QRP.
Yeah,
setup.
It was 500 milliwatts or so. But well, yeah,
Did you make a contact or just...
No,
check
we couldn't
log.
Make a contact.
Didn't make a contact, but we did see that our signal was actually picked up.
But we whipped that together in like a couple weeks prior. So I had some mixer ideas I wanted to play with. So I made my own commutating mixer design and, you know, stuck it in the box and wasn't totally pleased with it, but it put some power out a little bit.
Cool. I think the conference just kind of ended and walked down the hall.
It's probably going to the bar.
We're on our own.
I don't want to
hold you too much longer. We can go as long as we want. I'm dead tired.
We're pretty tired too, for two and a half days.
So my brain is about to shut down. So we'll do the Skype because you were telling me all kinds of cool stuff about your background that were not really ham radio that I would like to get into.
Okay. Yeah, I'd love to come on.
Yeah, and
if your audience doesn't mind a small amount of trolling,
not at all. Do you have any trouble, you know, traveling around with celebrity?
You know, it doesn't bother me at all. So, you know,
and Jeri's looking around saying, "Who's the celebrity? Yeah, is there one here?"
Most of the places we go, there's always at least one or two nerds that go, "Are you Jeri Ellsworth?" And I'll just step back and be like, okay, "Let her do her thing." You know, it's totally fine with me.
I find it funny. It's like I didn't do anything in particular. Like, I just made some YouTube videos and.
Well, yeah, you're unusual in that any woman that knows technology stands out some, but there are a lot of women who know technology. My wife knows technology, mm-hmm. sort of. As a ham, as a college dropout who never studied technology, but as a ham, I know more practical technology than she ever learned. But she's got, you know, she's got the double E's hanging on the wall.
Yep.
That gets you so far. What got you the next
I think just trying to push boundaries whenever I can and then stick it on YouTube. And it's resonated with folks. Like, I think my primary thing is figure out something that people think is impossible to do for just a regular human in their garage and try to do it. So, like, I set up a whole semiconductor line in my garage to do chips. So I do microchips in my garage. And, you know, I heard about this strange logic gate that was going to replace vacuum tubes in mainframes in, like, the 50s or 60s. And then transistors came along, and this magnetic logic gate, you know, died. It was just a short little sliver. I'm like, well, I want to see if I can build those. And so figured I spent a ton of time, figured out how to build those and put them online. And, you know, people like seeing that stuff. So
I think that there's, beyond just curiosity and interest, there's got to be a level of drive behind.
Obsession.
Yeah. Okay.
I might be pretty far on the Amy, Asperger's. Is that right? Asperger? No, not Asperger's. Is it Aspie?
Yeah, you're a little Aspie. Yeah.
Amy, you get to be the Snopes of Jeri Ellsworth.
I don't know. I have my own Aspiness, too. So. I get a little obsessed about stuff as well. So.
Yeah, cleaning out the office.
Oh, yeah.
She couldn't throw anything away because we have to move out of the space. And just
both of us might be a little bit of hoarders.
Perfect for ham
radio.
You need those oxidized HF connectors.
You never know when you're going to need them.
there's a lot of ham radio basements where the only path from one side to the other is this narrow aisle.
I'll buy that. I'll buy anything that's in their basement. Send it to me.
I've been in a few of those. I've moved enough that I've reduced, but there's a lot of stuff that I've got.
Even as
a non-builder, that a lot of stuff that has collected over the years. So, but something pushed you past the average, if there is such a thing, the average accomplished woman in technology, to starting companies, to
being
as recognized as you are.
I don't know. I think it's, you know, people told me no a lot, and I don't like hearing that. So when I raced cars, everyone's like, you're too young. You can't race cars. And I went out, figured out how to build them. And race them and sell them.
And win.
What?
And win.
And win, yeah. Be competitive. You know, say at my computer stores, people are like, well, you should just stick with that racing thing you're doing. You shouldn't give that up. You've established yourself. Like, why are you going into this, like, weird thing that you don't know much about? And electronics was the same thing. And just tell me no, and then I'll be like, oh, yeah? Well, I'll show you.
Yeah. Just watch her go.
It's kind of where we're at with the company now, but I can't say anything.
Yeah.
I wish we could.
Hopefully soon.
Watch. I am going to edit this in the hotel room because, you know, I have no life. Because I want to get this on right away. I have almost no upload speed, so it's going to take.
Which way is it?
Loser. It's almost no upload speeds because it'll be all night, but folks will see it.
You driving back or flying back?
I will drive back tomorrow. I'm going to go up and see my brother. He lives up the Mississippi a little bit in Rock Island, Illinois. Hmm. And go see
Sounds
him.
Delightful.
I don't get to see him very often. And then drive back.
Sounds like a good trip.
Play with my radio. You haven't seen my car, have you?
Does it look like a porcupine?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll show it to you before we're
done. Love it.
Sweet.
I zeroed extra in one swell foop.
Yeah, that was fun. The VEs were kind of cutting up with us when we went there. She went at the same time. We came a little bit late because we got caught in traffic, and it was like 1 hour-ish left. And they're like, well, you probably don't have enough time to make it through, because we said we wanted to do the
tech in general.
Yeah. Yeah, there might not be enough time. And we just whoosh, right through the first one.
Oh,
you got
perfect
on it, right?
Yeah, I raced through the technician. And sat there for a couple minutes before they realized I was done. And they were like, you're finished? I'm like, yeah, I'm ready for the general. Just can, you know, bring it on.
Now, did you start with a technical background? Did you do, first of all, are you a high school dropout?
I'm not. I actually have a master's degree. So.
Oh, my God.
Don't hold it against me, please.
we're both going to stare daggers at you.
I know. I have a background in my undergraduate was bachelor's of fine arts, so I did sculpture, film, and photography. And then
you discovered
there
wasn't much business opening a little fine arts store downtown.
Right. You either go back and, get your graduate and potentially, further than that and teach, maybe. And I had kind of an inkling to do that at one point in time. And then, I decided that wasn't really up my alley. And so I floundered for a little while and then met a professor at a university I worked for, and she convinced me I could do arts administration. And so I got into arts administration, worked at the city of Seattle for 14 years.
Not hearing any technology yet.
So technology comes in. I've been a builder pretty much all my life, like ever since I was a little kid. So
crafty builder.
Yeah. So just building stuff. Got into electronics probably a couple years before I met Jeri, started dabbling with making microphones.
How long has this collaboration been going on?
How long have I known her?
Yeah.
You were on the film crew for our Kickstarter video.
I was. Yeah. So.
It was the Kickstarter for
4 years ago. Yeah.
Okay. So just 4 years.
Yeah. So, So I started doing dabbling in electronics, and I'd been building all along. I've done things like I've built a teardrop camping trailer, remodeled my entire house, including all the wiring.
Okay. So not just macrame.
Oh, no. Yeah, no. Yeah, pretty much beyond that.
Sorry, I'm an old man.
No, it's actually funny. So after I finished my teardrop camping trailer and I would take it out camping, all of the old guys would love to come up and chat with me about it. And the first thing inevitably they would say is, "Who built it?" And I'd be like, "Well, I did." No, really, who built it? Was it your husband?
Did you uppercut him?
No, I'm like, oh, Jesus. Okay. I did everything from welding the chassis to building the entire body and everything else, so wiring it. So, yeah.
I'm just going to pack up my cameras and put on demo. I'm proud of what I know how to do, but I can't do any of that stuff.
Oh, you could. You just have to have the drive, and it's like anything can be learned pretty quickly.
Right. I probably could learn how. I just no
warm
interest.
That soldering iron up, and
that's right.
Get going. make a few mistakes.
I'm set in my ways. I'm old.
Yeah. So you got your technician perfect. I missed some because I scoff law and don't study anything about rules, and then I aced the general. Like really fast.
Yeah, I think I missed a couple on the jump.
And they're like, whoa. And then I'm like, okay, that's good enough for me because I hadn't studied any of the extra. And they're like, you might as well try. I'm like, oh, I don't know, not much time. Just do it. And like, okay. And so I was digging deep on that one because
it is a harder test. I mean, it's the ham test that has real engineering in it.
It's like, I haven't read a Smith chart in a few years. Like, okay, yeah, I think I got it. And then, I used this once 20 years ago. And I passed it.
Yep.
And what was funny is there was another gentleman in the class as well that had been trying to get his extra, and he had taken the test multiple times. And we were sitting there as he was taking the test, and he'd fail, and then he'd take it again. And for whatever reason, when it finished and they graded mine, they're like, you got the same score as he did. And I didn't realize he had just passed it. And I'm like, oh, and I start to walk out, and they're like, no, you passed. Come here. And I'm like, oh, woo.
Yep. Did you even try the extra? Or?
Oh, gosh, no. At the time, I had no idea what a Smith chart was. There was no way I was going to pass the extra.
I tried so hard to understand anything about Smith charts. I've got my extra, but that you can miss a certain number of questions. And so one of the pieces of advice for people going in is, study the stuff that you know you can get, and don't worry about the stuff that you know you can't, as long as it's going to fall within the stuff.
Right, margin of error.
Your margin of error, yeah.
No, that's good advice, actually, because I'm currently studying for the extra right now. Yeah. So
I missed two questions on my extra.
Wow.
One of them, I never got a Smith chart question, fortunately. One of them was one I should have known. It was something about VE qualifications. How could I miss that? That's not even technical. The other one, I don't remember what it was, but I did okay. My advice for anybody studying for ham radio is, you get the book or whatever, study a chapter, go take an online test.
Yeah, that's
because they're all over the place. My favorite is AA9PW because the website for that doesn't flash at you and give you a lot of advertising clutter.
Right.
It's very, very clean. And so go take the online test after chapter one. And if your ego can stand failing, because you're going to probably fail. If you passed it, well, go take your test. And then go do chapter two. And then take a few online tests and see you did a little better. Chapter three, a little better. By chapter five, six, you're probably passing.
Yeah.
By the time you finish, you will be acing them every time. And you'll walk into the test with Jeri Ellsworth-style confidence.
Yeah, there you go.
You just puff your chest up and just walk in.
Like. Yeah, yeah, exactly. So that's my recommendation for it.
Is your red light still on? I thought I saw a flash over there.
That's hard to tell. It's kind of bright behind there.
Yeah.
So, all right, let's wrap this up. You had mentioned when I first saw you, I was telling you, you got something else you want to say?
No, I was just
okay.
Like.
Are we done?
No.
Right. When I oh, there's
fly
a fly.
Keep us hovering around here.
We're attracting flies. What a stinker this is going to be.
Yeah, it's going to be the worst episode ever. When I met you last night at the social, and I was introducing myself, and you said you knew who I was and that you watched the show.
Yep.
But now we're going to find out if she's watched the show. We end the Ham Radio Now shows the same way every time. Most people never make it to the end. You'll be given absolute forgiveness.
It sounds like a trap.
Not making it to the end of a show. So if you've made it to the end of the show, you would say, I know exactly how you end the show. Let's just end the show.
Give me money?
No. There's a little
bit
of that.
No, that's the beginning.
It's also at the end. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you if you enjoy the program. And the interviews and stuff, and you can help me go on vacation, hamradionow.tv, visit Arvin, click the pig. Thank you very much.
Totally worth it.
David, eat your heart out that you're not here at this interview.
I'll take a guess.
My co-host.
Okay, go for it.
73?
Well, that would be pretty standard. There is within the radio communications history, a very famous way of ending, not necessarily conversations, because this is more Hollywood professional. I can't call it real professional because it's bad procedure. You know Dick Tracy?
I've heard of Dick Tracy.
The old Dick Tracy. Do you know what he would sign out his radio communication with? Pull it out. It's deep. It's in there.
It's in there. It's like extra test.
I'll give you the first part. 6-2 and even. We're not hitting.
It's going to go right.
No cylinders here.
No.
All right.
10-4, good buddy.
That could be it, but it's not. Now, okay, so.
Going 10-10?
We're seeing your CB roots. They're showing there. You need to get them dyed a little bit.
I'm walking the dog and kicking the cat.
Yeah, you're keep the shiny side up and the greasy side down. Yeah, that's not it.
Nope. We got time. I'll figure this out.
I guess a little bit of SD card room left. And it's bad radio procedure. I got to guest host Ham Nation for a few episodes before Bob Howell got mad at me and didn't let me do it anymore.
For your bad radio procedure?
My bad television procedure, apparently. Well, it's mostly because I didn't like the show when I wasn't hosting it, and I told too many people.
Awkward.
Yeah, I'm guessing that you understand that. So I ended the show the first time I did it with this bad radio procedure, and I immediately got email from people explaining the bad radio procedure. I knew it was bad radio procedure.
Tell me, Amy. Don't look to me.
Give us another hint.
I'll give you the first word.
No.
It's a three-word phrase. I'll give you the first word. Over.
Over, good buddy?
Not over, good buddy. 10-4, good buddy. Yeah, it's over.
Everything comes
over
back
out.
To CB
over,
radios.
Over and out. Because it's, and what makes a bad radio procedure is over means
Over to you.
You can transmit. Out means I'm gone.
So I'm passing it back over to you, but I'm out of here.
Well, that was my retort when I got this. The next Ham Nation I did, it was, you know, I explained it. You know, it was over and out. Is that you can start talking, but I'm not going to be listening. All right. So that's how we end the show.
That's great.
Jeez, that was protracted.
There's enough of it.
Sorry, folks.
That's a hallmark of this radio, of this this podcast. It's circuitous, never ending, just
over and out, good buddy.
Wander. Yeah. So there's enough of us here to accomplish this with one word each. So, and to be a little broadcasterly about it, tell people who you are again.
Oh, okay. I'm Amy Herndon. My call sign is Kilo Mike 6 Foxtrot Zulu Echo.
I'm Jeri Ellsworth. My call sign is AI6TK.
I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, host of the program, editor, producer, et cetera, et cetera. Sorry, David, you don't get to be on this one. Over.
And
out.
Like, ham radio is totally amazing.
I promised it would not be a scary show. And did I deliver?
That was fun.
There we go.
Anytime.
I'm still recording, by the way.
Like, oh my God, you're still recording.
Oh my God. Oh my God.